It's time to go. Well, good morning. I want to welcome you to Capital City Church this morning on this Christmas Eve morn, which is always kind of hard for me to say, as you found last week if you were here. But if you would like to, and you're visiting this morning, there's a welcome card in the pew that is located just right in front of you. You can grab that if you'd like to share your information with us. We'd love to have it. You can put that, and you will find an offering box out the double doors on the right-hand side there. Just put that in the offering box. Today's service is a little bit different in that we won't be passing any kind of a plate, so we won't be picking those up or any offerings up. And so if you're giving today and like to do that, also just put that back in the offering box on your way out this morning. Like I said, today's service is definitely different than what we would usually do on a Sunday morning. We order our service with a series of scripture readings that tell the story of Christmas, followed by kind of appropriate music with the choir, and then we do a shorter message that goes along with that. So with that said, we pray that this service will be a blessing to you, and if you don't mind standing, we're going to start it with the reading of the psalm, Psalm 98. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done wonderful things. His right hand and his holy arm have gained the victory for him. The Lord has made known his salvation. He has revealed his righteousness in the sight of the nations. He has remembered his loving kindness and his faithfulness to the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God. Shout joyfully to the Lord, all the earth. Break forth and sing for joy and sing with praises. Sing praises to the Lord with the lyre and the sound of melody, with trumpets and the sound of the horn. Shout joyfully before the King, the Lord. Let the sea roar and all it contains, the world and all those who dwell in it. Let the rivers clap their hands. Let the mountains sing together for joy before the Lord, for he is coming to judge the earth. He will judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with equity. Let's pray. Well, Father, we thank you so much this morning for this wonderful opportunity to come together on this eve of the night that we celebrate the Savior's birth. We come and like the psalmist says here, Lord, we desire to sing with our whole heart and our whole mind and our whole attitudes. And Lord, to do that, we know that and would certainly appreciate, God, that you would reveal to us sin that is left unconfessed in our lives, that we might confess it even now, Lord, that we might come to you as a corporate body, a people to worship you corporately, together, Lord, as we lift up our eyes and our hands and our hearts and our heads to you, our great God and King. Lord, we love you so much. We pray in Jesus' name. Well, you can be seated as we listen to a scripture reading and a musical prelude with bells and the choir.
We begin with Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 through 23. Now, the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us.
Come, O come, Emmanuel.
Please stand with us for a series of readings and songs, beginning with the birth of our Lord in Luke chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration when Quirinius was governor of Syria. And all went to be registered, each to his own town. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth. And she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling cloths, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn.
Please sing with us, church.
Infant, holy, heaven's highest love come down. For the poor you left a glory, and you laid aside your crown. Weak and helpless, hear you slumber in a stable with your mother. Shepherds gather round. Do they know you've left your crown? Holy, infant, holy, you who once held heaven's power, now you lie here cold and hungry in the sun.
Continue with John 1, verses 1 through 5 and 9 through 14 as we behold our Savior. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. The true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. Sing with us, behold the Savior.
Wear our shame. Come live. promise we have waited for. He will not leave us in the dark. He will bear our weight. He will wear our shame. Come, lift him high. Behold the Savior, Jesus Christ, God of love and life. Come, lift him high.
Together, church.
Here is the promise we have waited for. He will not leave us in the dark. He is the promise we have waited for. The cry of every searching heart. He will bear our weight. He will bear our shame. Come, lift him high, behold the Savior, Jesus Christ, God of love and might. Come, lift him high, behold the Savior. Come, lift him high, behold the Savior. Come, lift him high, behold the
We now come to Luke chapter 2, verses 8 to 14, and see the angels worshiping the Savior. And in the same region, there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not. For behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger." And suddenly, there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased." Please be seated now and enjoy listening to our children's choir sing "Hark the Herald Angels Sing."
Please stand for a reading and sing with us. We read Micah 5:2 and Luke 2:15 through 20 to see the prophecy and fulfillment of Jesus' birth at Bethlehem. But you, O Bethlehem Ephrathah, who are too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to be ruler in Israel, whose coming forth is from of old, from ancient days. When the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." And they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. And when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told them concerning this child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told them.
Church, please sing with us.
Thank you.
Amen. Please be seated.
Thank you for singing with us. What a wonderful time of year that we get to spend and celebrate the coming of our King. Amen. John Wesley Work Jr. was born in Nashville, Tennessee in 1871, just 6 years after the end of the Civil War. His father was the director of a church choir of which some members were part of the Fisk Jubilee Singers, a group of singers who traveled to raise money for Fisk University, which is a historically black college in Nashville, Tennessee. John Jr., like his father, also loved music, and while attending Fisk University, he would often organize singing groups and get together for events. He later graduated Fisk in 1895, where he had studied Latin and history and moved on to take his studies to Harvard University. Mr. Work Jr. would later return to Fisk University to teach, and it was during this season of his life he began to collect slave songs and spirituals. He then published those songs, and one of them will be very familiar to you. Let's see if you recognize its poetic words. While shepherds kept their watching o'er silent flocks by night, behold, throughout the heavens there shone a holy light. The shepherds feared and trembled when lo, above the earth rang out the angel chorus that hailed the Savior's birth. Down in a lowly manger, the humble Christ was born, and God sent us salvation that blessed Christmas morn. Go, tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ was born. Now, why should everyone go and tell that Jesus Christ was born? Well, it is because Jesus, the greatest gift given to all mankind, was born to reconcile all humanity back to the Lord. And why do I say back to the Lord? Some might in here say, aren't we all sons of God? And in one sense, we are. Without understanding, though, God's intent for his original creation, we can never rightly understand why Jesus would come to reconcile or save it. To reconcile something, well, it means that something must have been lost. And what was that lost something? Well, you'll remember that God created the heavens and the earth, and remember that he separated the light from the darkness on day one, and it was good. And what happened then on day two, that God created the atmosphere, and on the third, he separated the land from the water and created every kind of vegetation, and it was good. And on the fourth day, God created the sun and the moon, and on the fifth, he created all life, which was to live in the waters below and the birds flying above, and the Word of God says that it was good. Then on day six, God created all the creatures that creep and walk on the earth, and then he created the crown of all creation, and humanity was made, listen here, in God's image. You ever taken a selfie? Go ahead, admit it. You have, right? And you looked at the picture, and you decided whether you were going to delete it right away or not, right? It's embarrassing, right? We all done it. We are created in the image of God. Mankind, the only creation. Adam and Eve were given dominion there in the early chapters of Genesis as a king and a queen over all creation. In verse 31, the last verse of chapter 1 says that God saw all that he made, and behold, it was very good. Perhaps the most overlooked reality in the Garden of Eden narrative is the intimate fellowship that God had with Adam and Eve. Eden was designed for Adam's pleasure and his needs, and Adam had face-to-face conversations with the Creator God. Nothing inhibited their relationship as they would walk in the garden in the cool of the day. So it is, friends, before mankind was deceived by Satan, humanity enjoyed uninhibited fellowship with our Creator for eternity. What seems almost impossible to attain to now, even as a Christian who has access to the throne room, we have to fight through sin and thoughts and issues to spend time, to have that intimacy with the Father. All of that did not exist in the garden. Mankind, created in the image of God, walking with God in the garden in the cool of the day, hearing His voice and His instruction. So it is, beloved, that mankind, before being deceived by Satan, humanity had uninhibited fellowship with our Creator for eternity, a reality that none of us have ever experienced. And why? Sin infected humanity through Adam, and it disrupted that fellowship, did it not? And what began as very good in the garden turned out to be very, very bad. Genesis chapter 2 gives us more details about creation, especially concerning humanity. It is there that we read that God planted a garden called Eden, and He placed Adam there to cultivate and to keep it. And Genesis 2:9 says, "Out of the ground the Lord caused to grow every tree that is pleasing to the sight for good for food. The tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil." And verses 16 and 17 say that the Lord God commanded. Here he's speaking to Adam. He commanded the man, saying, "From any tree of the garden you may freely eat, but from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat from it, you will surely die." I don't know where you get your information, and we live in a day and an age where information just seems to kind of flow freely, and so often we joke about, you know, when we find something that we tend to believe in, you know, we say, well, we found it on the internet, right? And you should always believe everything you find on the internet. Well, listen, the God of truth, the God who spoke the universe into the existence, when He says something, it is true. There's no need to Google it. There's no need to wonder about it. He told Adam, "The day you eat of it, you will surely die." Now, there is simply no stronger way to warn Adam not to do something than this. At this point in creation history, nothing yet has died. There is no such thing as death. Humanity was created to experience eternal, intimate fellowship with our Creator. All was very good. But we know the history, don't we? Satan tempted Eve with the exact opposite words of God. Have you ever caught that in your study? When he said in Genesis 3:4 to Eve, "You surely will not die." Eve was deceived and ate, and Adam disobeyed the word of God, and he ate. He lost not only his eternal, intimate fellowship with his Creator, but also he spread his new fallen, sinful DNA to each and every human being in this room. And all became very bad. One of the most, if not most, difficult questions that Christians face is, why does an all-powerful and good God allow evil in this world? To know the answer to that question would be to know the mind of an infinite God who created everything and spoke everything into existence. It is not a knowable answer. Dear friends, one thing, though, that we can count on is this. God is not a liar, and He does not go back on His word. If He changed His mind, we could never trust anything He has ever said or done. Therefore, when He warned Adam not to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, lest he die, God is today, thousands of years later, keeping His promise. In fact, every person in this room is going to die. God is keeping His promise. And as the crown of all creation, the only creature made in the image of God, Adam, when he fell into sin, he lost the most valuable thing imaginable, an eternal, infinite, and intimate relationship with his Creator. And not only did Adam suffer the consequences of sin, but all creation suffered and died along with it. So, dear friends, why does an all-powerful and good God allow evil in this world? We cannot know perfectly, but we can know that a good God keeps his promise. A good God keeps his promise. And we can be thankful for that. Amen. Why? Just a few verses after Adam and Eve disobeyed and ushered in every fathomable kind of death, disease, and horrifying wickedness done by man, God made this promise to Satan in the presence of Adam and Eve in Genesis 3:15. He said this, "And I, that's the Lord, will put enmity," that is hatred, right, "strife between you," that's Satan, "and the woman, between your seed, Satan, and her seed, the woman. He shall bruise you on the head, and you shall bruise him on the heel." The Lord effectively says that they ushered in death and disaster, but the Lord can, without breaking his promise of death, he can reconcile those made in his image. And he's going to do through a child born of a woman. The whole Old Testament fleshes out, does it not, how God glorifies himself by keeping his promise. After the Noahic flood and the repopulation of the earth, God chose a man named Abraham and promised that the son would come from him. Abraham begot Isaac. Remember Isaac, Jacob, and Jacob had 12 sons who became the 12 tribes of Israel. From those 12 sons, God chose Judah to bring forth the promised son of Eve. And Judah's great-grandson was the second king of Israel, King David. And it was to King David that God made this unbreakable promise in 2 Samuel 7:16, saying, "Your house," that is David's house, "and your kingdom shall endure before me for how long? Forever. Your throne shall be established forever." Well, dear friends, the Old and the New Testament go into painstaking detail to follow the genealogy of the Son who was promised to reverse the curse of death. The New Testament genealogies tie Jesus to David. We read that just moments ago. And Jesus, the son of David, became the son of the woman who would bruise Satan's head. But let's remember the promise in Genesis that Satan would bruise Jesus' heel. And we know, don't we, dear friends, that the bruising of Jesus' heel took place on that cross. Jesus' most vibrant disciple, a fun study to study in your New Testament, this man named Peter, so full of life, so quick to speak. He wrote this in 1 Peter 3:18, "For Christ also died for sins once for all." Listen here, "the just," that's Christ, "for the unjust," that's us, all of us who are in Adam, right? "So that he," that's Christ, "might bring us to God." Did you catch that? What God began in the Garden of Eden, that is this eternal, intimate fellowship with him, lost through Adam's sins, he fixed in bringing us back to God in Jesus. You see, dear friends, the Virgin Mary conceived not by a man, and why? Why? Because God's curse of death passed through the seed of Adam. It passes through the seed of man. Mary had conceived by the Holy Spirit to give birth not to the son of Adam, who would be a sinner the first breath he took, but rather to the Son of God. All at once, Jesus, on this day that we celebrate tomorrow, was truly man and truly God. The Apostle Paul wrote this about the life, death, and resurrection of Christ in 2 Corinthians 5. He wrote now all these things are from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. Namely, verse 19, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them. And he was committed, and he has committed to us, that is the apostles, those who were preaching the word of Christ, the word of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were making an appeal through us. Listen to the appeal. We beg you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. Be reconciled to God. Why? Because God made him who knew no sin, that's Jesus, to be sin on our behalf so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Dear friends, there's no better time than right now in this Christmas season to be reconciled to God. The Bible says to confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead and you'll be saved from God's coming wrath on sinners and be reconciled back to your Creator. You see, death is the proof that we have all sinned. And the fact that the grave could not hold Jesus shouts from the mountaintops that through Jesus we can be reconciled back to God. We celebrate tomorrow what? The gift of life. A life. The life of the God child, right? The God man. And why? Because once what was once started back in God's intention for humanity all the way, all those years ago, he is going to one day reconcile us, all who will put their faith in Christ, back to God, back to that spot where we walk with him intimately and eternally. Amen. Mr. John Wesley Work Jr. wrote down these words after generations of oral tradition and singing. Down in a lowly manger, the humble Christ was born, and God sent us salvation that blessed Christmas morn. Dear friends, be reconciled to God and go tell it on a mountain. Amen. Jesus Christ is born. Let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for this day, this eve that we celebrate and anticipate. And we do that somewhat metaphorically, Lord, analogously, that in the morning we will rise and all the anticipation of receiving a gift, and Lord, yet you have given us the greatest gift to be reconciled to you, and you have made it as simple as repenting and confessing and believing upon your Son, Lord, who reconciled mankind back to you. Lord, we thank you for the message of Christmas. It is the message that should go out from our lives each and every day as Christians, Lord, and certainly we pray that it would. Help us, Lord, now to be those who will go and tell others about the great salvation through the Son of David, the Son of God, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Please stand with us on this cold day. We're going to send you out a little warm with Go Tell It on the Mountain.
Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. While shepherds camp there watching, or silent flocks by night, behold, throughout the heavens, there shone a holy light. Go tell. Jesus Christ is born.
The shepherds.
The shepherds fear and tremble when low above the earth. Ring out the angels' chorus that hail the Savior's birth. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the that Jesus Christ is born. Christ was born, and God sent us salvation that blessed Christmas morn.
Oh, go
tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. That Jesus Christ is born. That Jesus Christ is born.
Amen. That's a way to celebrate, right? Our Savior at His birth. Well, I want to thank you for joining us today. Please remember to drop off those welcome cards or prayer requests in your offering box that's on the way out. You can check the bulletin that you receive for any information and details. And if you need any prayer for anything, there'll be some here at the front of the church. If you have not put your faith in Jesus Christ as your Savior, it's as easy as we talked about today. We pray that you would come forward. We're happy to open the Bible and show you how you can be reconciled to God. Amen? So, love to pray for you. Myself and Valerie will be back in the Welcome Center. Love to meet you if you're visiting here today. And I really pray that you have a wonderful and merry Christmas. Let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for today, and thank you for the great love that you have given and sent us, Lord, in your Son, Jesus.